Today's reading is Psalm 3, which can be found on page 544 of the Church Bibles. That's page 544, and we're reading Psalm 3. This is a psalm of David when he fled from his son Absalom. O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you are a shield around me, O Lord. You bestow glory on me and lift up my head. To the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. I lie down and I sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear the tens of thousands drawn up against me on every side. Arise, O Lord, deliver me, O my God, strike all my enemies on the jaw, break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, morning. If we haven't met before, my name's Craig. I'm a new member of staff here. It's really good to be together this morning. Why don't I pray as we get stuck into Psalm 3. Heavenly Father, we come to your word this morning with a whole host of things floating through our minds, and not least pressure as we're going to touch on. Pray that we would have soft hearts and ears ready to hear from the living God this morning, regardless of whether we've yet decided whether he is a God we want to worship or live for. Amen. Amen. Well, as James brilliantly alluded to at the start of our service, we come to church and actually we start every day feeling with a degree of pressure on our shoulders, don't we? We at the days where we wake up carefree and without care in the world, they're few and far between. We often feel, to a greater or lesser extent, kind of burdened, weighed down. Boys and girls who are in the service this morning, it could be peer pressure at school. It starts when you're young, doesn't it? The feeling of pressure, pressure in our marriages at home, financial pressure, pressure from our boss at work. We could go on and on and on. You'll have to forgive me, I've got a sore throat, so I might have to have a drink as we go through this morning. And if we're Christians this morning, I take it we also know what it feels like to be under pressure, specifically for being Christians and living as Christians. Perhaps your mind already went there when we thought of pressure at the start of our service. Pressure or persecution, if you like, to conform to certain beliefs in our social circle, amongst our friends and our family. Perhaps even pressure to conform to certain beliefs in our denomination. Pressure to keep our faith private at work or even at home. Pressure. Well, Psalm 3, that was brilliantly read to us by Peter, speaks of that theme of pressure. It's quite a kind of a sobering psalm to start with, isn't it? Last week we ended on that high, if you look back over the page to the end of Psalm 2. Blessed are all who take refuge in him. And Psalm 3 then paints a very realistic picture of what blessing will look like sometimes. Will it all be an easy day? Oh, blessed is the Christian life. Well, hang on a minute, that's not my experience. Am I not a Christian? Am I missing out on something? Has something gone wrong? No. Psalm 3 says this is the blessed life. There will be pressure and persecution. Now, you'll see at the top of Psalm 3 that we're told this is a psalm of David when he fled from Absalom. It's recorded for us, that kind of period in David's life, 2 Samuel 15 to 18, if you wanted to go and read it later today. It's a period when David had been on the throne for a while, and then Absalom, his son, had risen up and I suppose sought a coup, and he'd got quite the backing, and so David has fled Jerusalem, he's legged it. In some ways, David had it coming to him, you know. We could go back to 2 Samuel 11 and see the things that David had done, the awful adultery with Bathsheba, the deceit and the cover-up that followed, the murder. And of course, then from that point forward, destruction followed David's family as a consequence of his sin. And yet one thing that's really important to remember is that unlike King Saul, who never repented really, David did repent. He was still God's king. And so wonderfully he was forgiven. And so that's why it was wrong for Absalom to kind of rise up and rebel against David. Because to rebel against David was to rebel against God. Rebel against God's king. Rebel against God himself. And as we've seen over the last few weeks, whilst this is true of David historically, it is ultimately even more so true of the Lord Jesus. David, as God's king, foreshadows the Messiah that was to come. And so what's historically true of him, ultimately true of Jesus. But we don't go far enough if we just draw the link between King David back then to Jesus who came. We need to draw another line to us today. Because throughout the ages, people have understood that the Psalms are true of David, true of Jesus, but then also true of us. If we'd call ourselves Christians this morning, what is ultimately true of Jesus and the things he can say, well, it overflows to us, his followers. And so we can pray this psalm this morning if we're trusting in Christ. And the first thing the psalm teaches us to pray as followers of Jesus is that we must, as we've alluded to, expect the pressure that comes with following Christ. Sorry, verses 1 and 2. Have a look down with me. O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. In the first line of verse 1, the foes there speaks of people who apply pressure, who squeeze in, who cause distress. And for David, they seemed to be everywhere, didn't they? But in the second line, the pressure seems to go up a notch. Those who apply pressure not are just kind of squeezing in on David, and they're not just all around him, but they're rising up. It's active. And that is exactly what happened to David as Absalom and his supporters squeezed in. And if David knew this, how much more so did the Lord Jesus know it? It describes the riot, if you like, that we saw in Psalm 2 last week. That pretty much everyone influential, everyone that was a mover and shaker, rose up and surrounded Jesus and squeezed him to the point of death. And they all rallied together. You had Jews, Gentiles, Herod, Pilate. They all became bedfellows as they sought to kill Jesus. But the surprise is the climax to these verses, which comes in verse 2, isn't it? What does he say? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. Now, boys and girls, if you're still with us a little bit, here's one of the things you might want to make a note of. Because we often hear it said, sticks and stones can break my bones, but words can never hurt me. But even as youngsters and actually as older folk, we know that that's just not true, do we? Actually, it's what people say which can cause the most pressure and the most persecution and the most difficulty to us. They're saying, your God's not real. And even if he is, he doesn't seem to care for you because look at your circumstance. Where's this God that's meant to be looking after you? I'm not quite sure what the word Selah means, but it means something to along the lines of a pause for thought to encourage a moment of reflection. So let's do that briefly here. I guess the thing that we ought to reflect on is this, is that this is David's experience, and we know that it's ultimately Jesus' experience, and well then, we must trust that it will overflow and be our experience today. As Jesus hung on the cross, they mocked and jeered him. Where's this God you speak of? Is he going to save you? And we should expect the same today. We should expect, as the body of Christ, to be squeezed, to be pressured by a hostile, skeptical, kind of unbelieving world. All around us, people will be saying to us, your God's dead, your God's not real. That thing that you kind of give so much of your time and your energy to, it's pointless, it's wasted. But ultimately, it's Satan's lies which affect us most deeply, isn't it? As a friend explained to me, when we're tempted to sin, the devil whispers in our ear, it's no big deal, God won't mind. And then if we succumb to the temptation, he whispers, that was terrible. Even God can't rescue you from that. For many of us, there'll be a specific act or a season in life where the devil whispers in our ear, time and time again, that's terrible. Even your God can't rescue you from that. We must expect this spiritual pressure, this verbal taunt. You'll be beyond help from God. David faced it, Jesus faced it, and so we, his church, will face it also. Forewarned is forearmed. And when we do it, must follow David's example of claiming the promise we have in Christ as well. And that's our second point. Claim the promises we have in Christ. You're a shield around me, O Lord. You bestow glory on me and lift up my head. To the Lord I cry aloud, but he answers me from his holy hill. Did you spot? David claims four promises. The first is safety in the first part of verse 3. But you are a shield around me, O Lord. Boys and girls, you might have studied the Romans at school, and maybe we can remember back to that time, and the Romans had these brilliant shields because not only were they in front of them, but they kind of curved round them. And as they packed in together, they would create this kind of tortoise shell, wouldn't they? They were protected from all sides. And David trusted, and so Jesus trusted as well, and so we can also trust that God is a shield around us. He protects us. Friends, there is nothing, no matter what pressure we face, that can separate us from the love of God. No attack, and not even an attack that results in death, can separate us from us. We are protected. Secondly, he claims the glory and the dignity that comes with being a Christian. Part of verse 3, you bestow glory on me. That's what opposition seeks to do, doesn't it? It seeks to undermine our dignity or our glory. They sought to undermine Jesus' glory as the Son of God. It's the same for us as Christians. People will seek to undermine us. Sure, our lives might not look glorious in the eyes of the world, but in God's eyes, they're completely the opposite. No matter how unimpressive our lives may be in the life of the world, we will always have glory, identity, dignity in this life and for all eternity in the eyes of the Father. Thirdly, he claims victory that's to come. And I lift up my head. It's an imagery of victory. Of course, David's this loser. He flees from Jerusalem, head covered, ashamed, embarrassed. He looked, well, like he'd lost. No victory there for him. And it looked the same for Jesus as he hung on the cross naked. He looked ashamed. He looked like he was a loser. And today, we as Christians, we look like losers sometimes. We're in the minority. We look like we've got it wrong, like we're on the wrong side of history. But of course, David wasn't on the wrong side. Jesus wasn't on the wrong side, and we're not on the wrong side. Not least because one day we will have that victory as we're raised to the heavenly realms to spend an eternity with our heavenly Father. And finally, he claims the privilege of prayer. That final verse, to the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. This was the privilege of being the Lord's king. David could cry to the Lord and he'd hear his prayers. Jesus prayed to his Father and he heard his prayers. And friends, today, if we're Christians, we can pray in Jesus' name, knowing that he intercedes for us. He hears our prayers. And let's just reflect on that briefly. Psalm 3 teaches us when we're under pressure as Christians, when our voice puts us under pressure, we ought to sue God for his promises. His promise of safety, his promise for glory, of victory, of the privilege of prayers that promised to be heard. And the Puritan Thomas Goodwin put it brilliantly like this. He said, sue him for it. Do not let God leave you alone. Do not leave God alone. Pester him, as it were, with his own promises. Tell him what he has said he's going to do. Quote scripture to him. It pleases him. God is our Father, and he loves us. He likes to hear us pleading his own promises, quoting his own words to him and saying, in the light of this, can you refrain from answering me? Now, we ought to expect the pressure that comes with following Christ. But when we do, claim the promises that we have in Christ. And when we do that, our expectation can be that we can rejoice in the rescue we have in Christ. Have a little look down at verses 5 and 6. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear, though tens of thousands draw up against me on every side. I don't know about you, but when I'm anxious about something, what's the first thing that goes? Well, it's sleep. Maybe it's the summer holidays at school. The sleep goes the first thing, and I get a bit weary, get a bit tired. You can probably tell. But what do we do is we think, okay, well, it will all be over soon. There is going to be a time in the future when this exam has passed, or this project at work has been finalized, or this this area of persecution or suffering, well, hopefully that will blow over. We say to ourselves, well, it will all be better when. Look forward to this happening once our circumstances have changed. Well, verse 6 makes it clear that there hasn't been a change in circumstance for David. Absalom's threat, well, it hasn't been nullified yet. And yet David is still able to lie down and to sleep. When I first read this psalm this week and was kind of meditating on it and praying about it, I was thinking, that is not my experience normally. Normally I sleep well once the thing is over, but he seems to be able to sleep in the midst of it. Boys and girls, you probably remember the story of Jesus calming the storm on the boat. You remember all the disciples were there and this big storm rose up. It was a picture of rebellion and chaos and sin in the world, but it was a storm as well. And of course, what was Jesus doing before he calmed the storm? Well, he was asleep. He slept. Now, of course, this side of creation, we will all experience sleepless nights due to worry. The point is this, is that we can enjoy this safety now. We can enjoy this glory now. We have the promise of victory now. It's real to us. The privilege of prayer, we can go to bed tonight, we can sleep well, knowing that all of that is signed, sealed, delivered, it's in the bag. And that is especially comforting when it comes to the sleep that we will not wake from. I'm attending my grandmother's funeral tomorrow, and of course, the last time she went to sleep, she didn't wake up. Well, it's not humanly speaking. But this language here of going to sleep and waking up again, well, it's actually language that is ultimately new creation, resurrection language. It's what Jesus said to Jairus' daughter. You know, she's not dead, she's asleep. She's going to be resurrected. And verse 5 kind of hints at this truth. Not only do Christians who fall asleep wake again in the Lord tomorrow morning, and we go, no, these promises are true, but because of these promises, when we die, we can be confident we will be woken up again, no matter what persecution we face in this life. Thank you for your patience with me. Final point, and then we're all done. Look forward to the victory we have in Christ as well. The final verses, 7-8. Arise, O Lord, deliver me, O my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. Friends, we can look forward to the deliverance that comes with victory. Arise, Lord, deliver me, my God. That was the prayer or the mantra, the chant that the God's people in the Old Testament would say as they would head out to battle. Of course, it's the exact opposite to what the mockers say, don't they, in verse 2? Your God won't deliver you. They can look forward to the judgment that comes with victory of those who rebel against God and his people. Second half of verse 7 is a kind of an insulting gesture, a slap to the face to put someone in their face. It's the imagery of a predator like a lion having their teeth knocked out. And so, of course, the threat is completely nullified. And not only can we look forward to the judgment that comes with victory, but to our rescue that comes with that as well. The Lord rescued David. He restored him to his throne. He rescued Jesus, resurrected him from the dead. And he will rescue us, his people. See verse 8. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. Friends, ultimately this is a psalm all about salvation, about deliverance, about rescue from opposition. And the point of verse 8 is that because God rescued David and because he rescued Jesus, we can trust that he will rescue us if we're trusting in Christ. The rescue that Jesus experienced in terms of dying to sin and being rose again, well, that overflows to us. When we face similar to opposition to what he faced, similar pressure to what he faced, we can look forward that we have similar privileges and we will have a similar outcome, well, the same outcome as what Jesus had. We will be risen again in glory. And we're going to see this motif more next week with James of lying down and sleeping as we come to Psalm 4. But why not try praying or singing this psalm if you can't sleep this week? Why not try coming back and seeing the journey the psalm takes us on when we face pressure and persecution and suffering in this life? And it's not a case in the Christian life of grinning and bear it, but coming and being reminded, no, this is okay. This is par for the course for the Christian. Be challenged to claim the promises of Christ. Sue God for his promises, as that Puritan said. And be moved to rejoice in the rescue we have. I take it that's why we sing gladly, because we come to church with pressures on our shoulders. And as we praise God together, we rejoice and see all that we have in him. And friends, ultimately look forward to the future victory we have in Christ, that when we fall asleep in death, we will surely be resurrected again. Let me pray for us as we close. Ah, my Father, though my voice has failed me this morning, we thank you that your word is so powerful, that it comforts us, that it engages with us, that it meets us where we're at and yet lifts our eyes to a glorious future to come and all the privileges we have in Christ. We rejoice in that and pray that we would be greatly comforted, challenged, and sharpened by your word this morning. Amen.